existed, and has been with TUG since its founding, and today she's going to talk about the Styx project, another long-term, although not quite as long-term yet, project about Unicode and fonts.
This is actually a semi-repeat of a talk that I gave at the Council of Science Editors in May, and I've updated it because things have actually happened between then and now. So, okay, this is essentially what I'm going to go over. The addition of a great deal of stuff to Unicode, the development and implementation of the fonts, and what happens next? Okay, what is Unicode? This is the coding system on which all modern computers that I know of are based. There are, the scheme is divided into blocks. A full block contains 256 characters. A plane contains 256 blocks. This is your basic hex counting. There are 17 planes in Unicode because plane 0 is not counted among the 16 that are allowed by the hex numeric scheme. And the basic multilingual plane is where, up to now, almost everything has happened. And so for software to claim that it supports Unicode, it has to be able to access at least everything in the basic multilingual plane, which is plane 0. Unicode started out as a mechanism to allow all the world's natural languages to be communicated in a natural form, as opposed to, you know, having to transliterate or use other artificial schemes for switching back and forth between other. When the Styx project started, math was not considered a language. And you'll see very shortly why it's important that math be considered a language. So Unicode claims to encode semantics. In other words, it encodes meaning, not the appearance. Now, it's quite true that a lot of math symbols differ only by appearance. And I think this was one of the reasons that Unicode did not contain nearly as many symbols as it could, because they claimed, oh, well, this symbol means the same as that one, so we'll only encode one. And especially in the case of alphabets, you allegedly have only one character with a single shape. This is not completely true, because in Unicode, you do have a complete Greek alphabet, you do have a complete Roman alphabet, and you do have a complete Cyrillic alphabet, and the letter A looks, it's indistinguishable to me what the differences are between those. However, what is a glyph? This is where we get into the fuzzy areas of Unicode. They claim to encode characters, not glyphs. So all your variations on A here are all glyphs. According to Unicode, when we started, they were just one character, A. That's it, with the cell number hex 41. But when you get into mathematical notation, this no longer works. If you consider Hamiltonian equation beloved of physicists, if you are silly enough to change this script H, which has a very distinctive meaning, to just an ordinary H, oops, there's one over here, this is utter nonsense. I mean, it may mean something, it doesn't mean anything to me, and it certainly is not going to mean anything to a physicist. So for technical notation, you need one character represented by one glyph, and you need them all to be encodable. there are other kinds of variations where, in fact, you do have just a single character summation sign. Well, common practice in technical publications is that inline you have a smaller form and the limits are set as super and subscripts, but you have actual limits and a larger form in display. But that is still just one character. So there's no problem in having just one character in Unicode, but now you have problems with your typography. Who's ever doing the typesetting has to know the difference and the practices. So you can have multiple glyphs representing one character. Okay, the natural language support in Unicode has been very good from the time it was first instituted, which was sometime in the 80s. There were older coding schemes, but this was really the first attempt to make it cover all the world's languages in sort of in their native form. And the first 20 blocks of the code, basic Latin, the ASCII character set, and controls. These are all in plain zero, by the way. You have Latin 1, which is enough accented letters to cover all the Western European languages. These first two segments are what is in block zero. You have Greek, full Cyrillic, you have combining diacritics, Hebrew, Arabic, the scripts for many languages of India and Southeast Asia. Everything is in plain zero, but very few math symbols. The math symbols that are in common use today can make use of some of the characters that are already in plain zero. There are two groups of combining diacritics, some that are mainly for use with letters, and some that are mainly for use with non-letter symbols. For example, a slash, a negation slash, is fairly rarely used for striking through letters, although there are some places where that's used. Greek, and during the course of the negotiations with the Unicode Technical Committee, it was decided that the upright light face form of Greek is what would be represented by what is in plain zero. It's the same for the Latin alphabet. Upright light faces is what is in block zero. Had quite a few arrows, some mathematical operators, a block called miscellaneous technical, block called geometric shapes, and there are others scattered in random locations like punctuation and other groupings that the names don't mean a great deal to me, so I've not mentioned them. This is essentially what we started out with. As a matter of fact, this is more than we started out with, because this last block of arrows, the last column, was mostly empty, and the last column of the mathematical operators was also mostly empty. And these actually are from Unicode 5. We started with Unicode 2, where this was basically what we had to start with. It will cover high school math quite nicely, but if you want to go much further, it doesn't get there. So the first part of the STIX project was to get more math symbols into Unicode. And the key decision that I think was made was to accept math as a language. It's the means of communicating between people who work with in technical fields, and notation is much more easily recognized than trying to talk in different natural languages and with all the problems with translation. That's not needed when you can represent something in a mathematical expression. So what we managed to get added was about 1,000 characters that were symbols, and also a block of what's called mathematical alphanumerics. Now those were shoved off into plane one. This includes things like fracture, italic, bold italic, script, and sans serif, because that also has specific meaning in some technical standards. The idea of putting it in plane one was to sequester it where, if you really wanted to use it for a wedding invitation or some other fancy thing, you'd really have to work hard. Rather than being nicely laid out like the alphabet in ASCII, everything is just glommed together. It is in order, but there's no way to calculate the location easily. You're going to have to work real hard, and then if some computer application tries to read it, it will be utter nonsense. So it's not, it is not text. So if you want to render a some sort of invitation in a fancy script, use markup. There are lots of fonts out there that will satisfy you. This is not the proper use of Unicode. Okay, for the real math symbols, the odd shapes, about 1,000 of those were added too, and here are the new groups that were assigned. Miscellaneous mathematical symbols, A. Miscellaneous mathematical symbols, B. Supplemental arrows, A. Supplemental arrows, B. Miscellaneous symbols and arrows. And they've actually got a couple of blocks now that are reserved for additions. They decided not to encode symbols that can be constructed from a combining diacritic and a base symbol unless they were already there. For example, a not equal is already there, not greater, not less than, already exist in Unicode. They didn't say don't use those, but they just said we're not going to add any more because potentially you can negate almost anything, and Unicode has got a large area to work in, but not that large. For the same reason, subscripts and superscripts are not separately encoded unless they were already there, which the numerals are, and a few letters, but anything else that's going to be rendered as a superscript or subscript, you have to use markup to get that.
So
we didn't consider that, actually. There were several things in the corpus that we used and presented to the Unicode technical committee that they said, yes, these things probably should be in Unicode, but you're not the right person to submit them. You're not the right group, because we were specifically limited to the math and technical areas. There are a few symbols where a variation can't be constructed using a combining diacritic, and that's where just a portion of the symbol is negated. And so here you have two variations. And the use of these probably mean exactly the same thing, but it's usually a house style that says to use one or the other. So Unicode provided what they call a variation selector with the code position FE00 that can be tacked on as if it were a diacritic to make this kind of distinction between a very limited set of characters that exhibited this kind of structure. Now, I guess I'm a little logically out of order here. This is how you submit a proposal to Unicode. You have to use a standard proposal form and you have to provide a list of the proposed characters, including the names that are recommended. Unicode is very fussy about the names that they give to things. They want the names, obviously, to be unique and also to be recognizable insofar as possible by someone who doesn't actually know may not know the characters and may not have charts with the actual shapes on them. To be accepted, you have to prove that these have actually been used. You can't just say, oh, this is a nice shape. I want to submit it to Unicode as a character. That's not good enough. If you can provide an example in a publication from a reputable source, any of your major publishers or a known technical journal, that's good enough actually for them. You have to identify relationships with existing characters, and in the case, say, of a symbol that is negated, they may come back and say, well, you can create this by using a base character that's already there and a combining diacritic that already exists. Actually, we did add several combining diacritics to make this possible and cut down on the real estate that was required in Unicode. And they prefer that you can identify the supplier of a computerized font that contains these symbols so that they will be able to print the next edition of the standard without having to commission font work themselves. Though they do have a couple of very good font creators there. Now, if you're going to do this, you have to be prepared to become involved in the process. You can't just send in a piece of paper and expect something to happen. They will want you to come and champion this, or find somebody who's already on the Unicode Technical Committee to champion the edition. And as Peter knows, standardization on an international level requires a significant effort on the part of the submitter. It was 3 years before we really got to first base with the Unicode Technical Committee for them to agree that, yes, math is a language and we are willing to accept your proposal. And there was still significant niggling after that. So all in all, it took about 5 years for the bulk of us to get into Unicode. So now we've got our coded characters. How can we put them on paper? We need fonts. The six participants in the STIX project, the major participants, were American Physical Society, American Institute of Physics, American Chemical Society, IEEE, the American Math Society, and Elsevier. Together, they decided that Times Roman was the font that they would all accept. So essentially, Times was the basic font around which the STIX fonts were created. Now, there are reasons that Times was popular for typesetting technical material. It's compact, so you can mash a lot of material on a page. This means fewer pages. This means that it costs less for the publisher to produce. And because a lot of publishers had adopted it, also a large number of symbols were already available. So this was a reasonable starting point. Now, what is special about a math font? When you're getting into the alphabetics, each letter has to be recognized individually in isolation so that someone seeing a letter all alone with no real context can recognize exactly what it is immediately. So one of the classic switches in times, and this has been done from, you know, the very first use of times for math typesetting, the V, excuse me, is too sharply pointed, and it is very easily confused with a new. Now, I know that this is not times, but you can believe me when I say that the V just was not suitable. So a substitute V had to be provided. And if the people I've asked who I believe should know, Century Schoolbook V was the one that was usually substituted for the times V when used in math expressions. And because the V and the W look so much alike, the W is also usually substituted so that they look related. So what else is important? Hairlines have to be fairly thick. Now, some of these things are because of modern practices. So you don't want the shapes to break up in sub and superscripts. We're talking about smaller and smaller images. And these days, people photocopy things and hand them on. So in the sixth photocopy, it may not be a whole lot different from the sixth carbon. So other considerations is the normal weight must be readily distinguishable from the bold. The result of this all is that, an alphabet that's intended for use as symbols may really not be usable for continuous text, and we didn't consider that it needed to be. So this is another reason for segregating, say, the fraktur intended as math symbols or the script. It's going to look pretty awful if you actually try to set something with it, if these are your criteria. So we're talking about humongous number of characters and glyphs. It has a mind of its own. So there was an awful lot of bookkeeping involved. First of all, we had to create the initial collection and associate the symbols that we could with existing Unicodes. And this is something that was left to me. And it turns out, in hindsight, that some of the selections that I chose were not particularly good, so we had a bunch of cleaning up to do at the end. But if there appeared to be a suitable Unicode, that was assigned to a particular symbol. If there wasn't an existing Unicode, we provisionally assigned a unique ID in the Unicode private use area. And this was just totally in random order. So if you wanted to find symbols that were related to one another, it wasn't really easy. I tried to give them names that I could find with a text search in the table that I constructed, but it wasn't easy to find everything. So the sources for these symbols, I started with the MathML entities, the SGML entities in ISO Technical Report 9573 Part 13 and others. There were significant contributions from all of the STICS organizations, and while there was a great deal of overlap between what was submitted by each group, it was by no means a complete overlap. There are a number of symbols that were submitted just by one. And Elsevier, in fact, among the symbols they submitted was a phonetic alphabet because they had done a great deal of typesetting in the linguistic area. And, well, they're in the STICS font by historical accident. There were some of those symbols that were not in Unicode. And this is among the group of symbols we were told, yes, it probably belongs in Unicode, but you're not the people to submit the request. Wolfram also submitted a number of symbols and a number of other individuals and organizations or individuals on behalf of organizations add still more. We sort of scoured the countryside to have as complete a submission as we could. So also, we tried to identify the symbols by the names by which each source refers to the symbol so that we could find out easily from a table who had submitted what. In case there were questions, we knew who to go back and ask. The number of instances of each that were required, because potentially we had chosen for our basic set, at least for the alphabets, for, because this is supposed to accommodate text too, so we had upright Roman, upright Italic, and both of those were also both in light face and bold. So for letters, and I'm excluding what we call the math alphanumerics here, but for letters that were meant for use of associated text, there were four possible instances required. Now, there are some other symbols for which many more instances are required. For example, sized braces, diacritics that can go over more than one character, and a number of others. And then finally, a description of what this thing was. We created an RFP and asked for bids for creating the font. If I remember correctly, there were four organizations who finally bid. Since Unicodes hadn't been assigned yet for many of these, the contractor that was chosen kept using the initial unique identifier all the way through the procedure. And as we came across additional things that people found they needed, we added them in and sent them off to the contractors as additions. The working database within the STIX group contained the information on the phase in which items were delivered or corrected, the name of the font that was created, where you could find the particular glyph, and the location of the glyph in the font. I didn't put the font information into the what I consider the master list, but I did insert all the newly assigned Unicodes as they happened. Now, if anybody ever submits a request to Unicode, and you are given a provisional code, don't believe it. Don't do anything even semi-permanent with it until it's actually been published. Because we had some corrections to make at the last minute where codes had been switched, the assignments had been switched, even at the point where Unicode, which feeds into the ISO standard 10646, there were a few changes of codes at that point. Once they're in 10646, they are frozen. They will never change. So you can be sure at that point that the code that is assigned is the one that something is going to keep. We also had to cross-reference everything. We had to provide names to be used within the font. The original fonts were in type 1 form, and that's how they were delivered. So I assigned glyph names according to the Adobe naming standard. I assigned tech names to anything that was to be used in a math context, but not to ordinary alphabets. Those are only going to be used for text, and I see no reason to clutter up the landscape with additional names if it's if they're never going to be used. And then finally, entity names for MathML for anything that didn't have it already. Shortly before the final delivery, we had to make a grand check to see that nothing had been left out. In fact, some things were overlooked, so we sent what we thought was a final list to the contractor, and that we thought was the end of that. Well, not quite. One thing that almost nobody believed would happen or would be necessary was a design review. It turned out that this was very important because Unicode assignments can be scattered. You can have the codes for two symbols that are almost identical that are, say, 1,000 numbers apart, and no real way of associating them with one another. So we had to make sure that things that were supposed to look alike and have the same shape and weight really did. So we knew that shape and content corrections were needed. What I did for this was to reorganize absolutely everything except the basic alphabets into groups reflecting the shape characteristics irrespective of the Unicodes. And these are all of the categories that I divided things into. Within each category, there were some symbols, especially the geometrics, that Unicode had said, okay, from the evidence you've given us, different sizes do make a difference. So they distinguished between the different sizes, and you can see these are the main geometrics and the size distinctions that were made by Unicode with the codes. From the lists that I sent to the person who was doing the corrections, who, by the way, is not the same as the original contractor, is a professional typographer who has a great deal of experience in technical material because he used to work for Elsevier, he sent back proof sheets. And they were in a large size, which I believe is 24 point, though I'd have to check it. And then in context also, the symbols just between two X's to give an indication of what the side bearings were. He sent me PDF files. I printed them out. I looked at them. I commented on them, sent back my comments, and we just corresponded in this way until everybody was happy. And most groups of symbols required no more than two cycles for approval because the person who was doing the correcting did a fabulous job and he knew exactly what to do in most cases. So what do we have left to do? The design review was done early in May. The fonts are now being packaged. They will be released in the form of OpenType fonts for review, for a beta test. User documentation has to be written, LaTeX support has to be provided, and MathML entity names have to be coordinated to make sure that everything agrees with what the MathML working group believes is real. So we're just about ready for the beta test. My best guess is that it will happen at the end of August or sometime in September. Then to use them, well, we have to make sure that the tools, the computer applications that allegedly use Unicode fonts are available. That's what we're hoping to find out from the beta test. Then, what's left? Unicode is prepared to accept new submissions with evidence of use. They have agreed that math notation is open-ended, so new symbols are going to come up. Math is a language, so now it just fits into their scheme of things quite happily. Is there a mechanism for adding to the fonts? It's not going to be done by the Styx group, so I don't know the answer to that. And if you want to learn more, there is the Saga of the Unicode efforts is at the AMS site, and the Styx Fonts web pages are at styxfonts.org. That's it. This has to be hashed out again. I keep trying to say, you know, run it by people who know what an open font is, because we do want it to be on CTAN. We do want it to be on Tech Live. The AIP lawyers, on the other hand, who wrote the license, well, they're lawyers. Nothing. No. That'll be separate. They will be in the table that I have posted. I have not posted the final version, but that will be posted at the AMS site. Taka?
You said terms of the alpha type. Would you be using any of the alpha types, like the
font designer who has been doing the corrections doing the packaging, you may know, Kuhn Hoffman, is corresponding with them to, so that insofar as possible, things will be common. Chris? Okay. Peter, you have?
Yeah, I mean, you started up with the description of some of the problems of trying to get
taken care of already. There's a big square block that's a combining diagram.
Okay.
Well,
so somewhere amongst the stuff that you've got is a potential symbol that has not been accounted for, and so they will want this included.
Well,
if this turned out to be some senior physicist who's invented it, it's going to be used for 40 years, then it's going to be needed. So,
if the publisher accepts this, and it is published by a reputable press, they will accept this as evidence.
Sure. But the point is, it is an ongoing changing situation. It's unlike A, B, C, D, F, through.
That is correct.
It doesn't kind of change very much.
That is correct. As I said, they have admitted that it's open-ended and accepted that. So they're prepared.
They think they're prepared.
Well, yeah.
The Styx Fonts project, is that only for the math, or will it include a times compatible font?
Oh yes.
Text. Okay.
It's supposed to be
everything.
You're supposed to be able to set text
can
with it.
Repeat your question.
Can it be used for text as well? And yes, you should be able to set text in Latin, Greek, or Cyrillic. Those three alphabets are there in their entirety in forms that can be used for text.
And available to use in September?
A beta.
Beta, okay.
Thank you, Barbara.